Good morning and welcome to Zion Lutheran Church of Pittsfield. I'm Reverend Anna Woofenden, the transition pastor here, and it's my honor to welcome you as we gather together, separated by geography, but together in spirit this morning on Pentecost Sunday. We are grateful to everyone who is part of creating our worship service this morning and to all of you for gathering. I want to remind you that during the interlude after the sermon, you're invited to type your prayer requests in the chat box, and Cheryl will read them aloud during the prayers of the people. There's a bit of a delay between what happens on Zoom and what happens on Facebook. So if your prayer request does not get named, know that it is heard by the community and by God, and that we are including that in our prayers. If you have a candle in your worship space, I invite you to light it now as we still our bodies, quiet our minds, and open our hearts to God here with us. This week we have yet again been reminded of the racism, injustice, and inequality in our country and in ourselves. And as we start worship together, I invite us to come in to worship the time of confession and prayer. These words, not in your bulletin, but they are on the screen for us to pray together. Holy God, for the racism, which denies dignity and humanity to your beloved children. Lord, forgive us.
Lord, have mercy.
For the racism which recognizes prejudice in others and never in ourselves. Christ, forgive us.
Christ, have mercy.
For the racism which will not recognize the work of your Spirit in that which is uncomfortable. Lord, forgive us.
Lord, have mercy.
Gracious God, we thank you for making one human family of all the peoples of the earth and for creating the wonderful diversity of cultures, races, and ethnicities.
Enrich our lives by ever-widening circles of fellowship and show us your presence in those who differ most from us.
Forgive us for when we have been silent and apathetic in the face of racial intolerance and bigotry, both overt and subtle, public and private.
And take away the arrogance and hatred which infect our hearts.
Break down the walls which separate us.
And help us to work for the justice and dignity that will enable us to become your beloved community.
Empower us to speak boldly for justice and truth, and help us to deal with one another without hatred or bitterness, working together with mutual forbearance and respect.
And work through our struggles and confusion to accomplish your purposes.
Amen. Continuing, we give thanks for baptism. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with him to new life. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give thanks to you, O God, for in the beginning you created us in your image and planted us in a well-watered garden. In the desert, you promised pools of water for the parched, and you gave us water from the rock. When we did not know the way, you sent the Good Shepherd to lead us to still waters. At the cross, you watered us from Jesus's wounded side, and on this day, you shower us again with the water of life. We praise you for your salvation through water, for the water in this font and for the water everywhere. Bathe us in your forgiveness, grace, and love. Satisfy the thirsty and give us the life only you can give. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O God, on this day, you open the hearts of your faithful people by sending us your Holy Spirit. Direct us by the light of that Spirit, that we may have right judgment in all things and rejoice at all times in your peace through Jesus Christ, your Lord, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from Acts. When the day of Pentecost had come, the apostles were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean? But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray together our responsive psalm, selections from Psalm 104. How manifold are your works, O Lord!
In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures.
Yonder is the sea, great and wide, with its swarms too many to number.
Living things, both small and great.
There go the ships to and fro.
And Leviathan, which you made for the sport of it.
All of them look to you.
To give them their food in due season.
You give it to them, they gather it.
You open your hand, and they are filled with good things.
When you hide your face, they are terrified.
When you take away their breath, they die and return to their dust.
You send forth your spirit, and they are created.
And so you renew the face of the earth.
May the glory of the Lord endure forever.
O Lord, rejoice in all your works.
You look at the earth and it trembles.
You touch the mountains and they smoke.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live.
I'll praise my God while I have my being.
May these words of mine please God.
I will rejoice in the Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Can you picture yourself with those early disciples? You've been busy following Jesus for a while now, and you've had your rhythm and your routine down. There's a lot of walking and stopping on hills and plains for Jesus to teach. There was usually some feeding that would go on and a healing miracle or two. People joined the traveling group and some stayed and some went away, but this core of disciples was getting pretty tight. They had great plans among them for how they were going to change things, bring about a new kingdom, and that Jesus would lead them to finding a more just and abundant way of life. Things were going along for the disciples, and then it all changed. They gathered in that upper room during the feast of the Passover, and Jesus kept telling them that he was going to die. He kept trying to prepare them for his crucifixion, but they really didn't get it. He washed their feet and prayed for them, broke bread, named it as his body, took the cup and blessed it as his blood. And the next day he was captured, taken, and crucified. And his disciples thought it was all over. Until, plot twist, on day three, he rose again, and Jesus was resurrected, and the tomb was found empty, and the Jesus who was dead and his crucified body was nowhere to be seen, and he then started showing up. He showed up as the gardener in the garden, and he showed up walking down the road to Emmaus. For 40 glorious days, Jesus was back, walking through walls, breaking bread, eating fish for breakfast on the beach, forgiving, healing, teaching, promising them the Holy Spirit, and talking all about the kingdom of God. But now he's going on about how he's going to leave them again, and they're not ready. They don't know what to do without them, and they're so tired, and all they really want is to settle into a new way of being, the way that they thought Jesus was going to make it all better. When can we go back to normal, Jesus, they asked. And I imagine Jesus saying, there's no normal. And then he breathed the Holy Spirit. And then he ascends into heaven and sends his disciples out into the world. Now, there are a lot of bits and different endings to this story, depending on which gospel account you're reading, but they all end with the same result. Jesus' disciples no longer see Jesus amongst them, and they miss him, and they don't know what to do. And so they head back to that upper room where they've been hanging out those last 40 days, and they decide to wait it out together and care for one another. I can imagine they went over all the things that Jesus had taught them and charged them with. They thought about what did it mean to be a disciple and to teach and heal, to witness and witness to Christ, even to the ends of the earth. They started to do these things together. They practiced them. They started being, well, that early church together, even though they didn't really even know what that meant yet. The disciples devoted themselves to prayer, all the disciples, including the women as well as the men, and they added a few more to their ranks, and they figured out maybe who the new leaders should be, and they were all together in one place one morning when all of a sudden come those tongues of fire and the rush of the Spirit on Pentecost. They are all of them, mind you, filled with the Holy Spirit, the book of Acts tells us. And they begin to speak in other languages, and people from all over the place are hearing them speak in languages that were their own. I can imagine they were looking at one another and suddenly connecting and speaking with people that maybe they couldn't have connected with before. Maybe listening like they hadn't been able to listen before. And in this moment, the church was formed, infused by the Holy Spirit while listening and speaking and connecting with one another in ways that they were not accustomed to. This church was formed in this time where they didn't know what to do next. They were praying and wondering and fumbling along while missing Jesus. And then this rush of wind filled the entire house, and these fiery tongues rested upon each of them. And God showed up where they were, and God helped them to understand one another and the people in the town and the broader community, and the Holy Spirit poured over everyone, regardless of who they were. All the people of God had God's Spirit poured upon them and were called together to follow God. The Acts account gives us this powerful and vibrant vision of the giving of the Holy Spirit, the beginnings of the Christian church. And it's a story with surprise and shock value, a very public statement of what this band of Jesus followers were all about. The Gospel of John gives us another angle in. We see the disciples, once again, in a locked room. Maybe it was that same upper room where they had shared the Last Supper with Jesus. Jesus shows up with them where they are and says, "Peace be with you," and then goes on to commission them to continue in his work. "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." "Receive the Holy Spirit," he said. Now, if you go back to the original Greek, you'll find that there is a nuance in this. It is not an invitation, but a command. It's not kind of a, hey, if you feel like it, receive this Holy Spirit, and then maybe go do some things. But instead, it's a, here, take this Spirit. And with it, the gifts, but also the responsibilities. Taking a deep dive into these just few lines of scripture is honestly sobering. What does it mean to forgive sins and retain sins? How does that connect with being followers of Christ, with being the church? How do we employ Jesus's call not to judge while discerning the sins of ourselves, of others, and the sins of society as a whole? And then discerning what needs to be forgiven and what needs to be retained. Theologian and pastor Reverend Martha Spong challenges us that sometimes a faithful response to Jesus's instructions to those gathered in the upper room is to retain sin. That is, she says, to hold on to it, to consider it with the weight it deserves. We hold on to particular sins, she writes, not from a posture of bitterness or malice, but with a mature understanding of what cannot be sustained and supported by the human community. We agree that some things are too terrible to put behind us, lest they be repeated for future generations or by us next week or next year. We don't have to go far to think of examples that connect and relate to Reverend Spong's challenge. There are sins that need to be examined, considered, interrogated, and worked over so that we are confronted with our part in them and take action to be inspired and fill with the Holy Spirit to make substantive change. We look at the travesties and tragedies throughout history and we say, never again. And yet, the sins of anti-Semitism continue long after the Holocaust is over. Starvation and poverty continue, even after some particular season of drought or flood or economic crisis are over. And white supremacy and racism continue to plague our country, 400 years after white English colonists introduced chattel slavery to the Americas when they brought 20 enslaved Africans to Virginia, 150 years after the Civil War, and decades after the Civil Rights Movement. These are sins, friends, that we are all connected to, that we benefit from in various ways, and that we continue to have that call of Jesus to wrestle with, to retain. The sins of racism, white supremacy, and people profiting and benefiting from the bodies of others is a sin that's been perpetuated throughout generations, including, and yes, maybe even especially at times, in the church. This is hard to wrestle with. This is that work of the Holy Spirit that calls us to retain so that we may examine and look at it, so that we may repent and change. The Reverend Lenny Duncan, an ELCA pastor in his book, Dear Church, A Love Letter from a Black Preacher to the Whitest Denomination in the U.S., which I highly recommend this book if you're looking for a way to continue learning, makes the clear call and connection to how the predominantly white mainline church in this country has systematically marginalized the Black congregations and siblings of Christ who are people of color. He wrestles with these sins we retain, the sins of racism and how, as a church, we are complicit. And he reminds us that the foundational pieces of our faith, such as the discernment of what sins need to be retained and which ones forgiven, can lead us and can support us in digging deeply into the changes that need to come. He writes, but whenever racism or racial justice is being discussed in our church, someone will inevitably ask, how do we get to reconciliation? How do we heal this? As Lutherans, he writes, we've been trained to search for reconciliation. But then he challenges us to take this practice of confession. And he said, like a person clearing their throat, when I pause during the confession and forgiveness, creating a space between the confession and the forgiveness, that pause, it's like that invitation that we don't want to wait between repentance and reconciliation. That silent pause is the moment for us to see ourselves for who we truly are. And it's scary, he writes. looking deeply at our sins, the sins that we are connected to by being part of society as a whole, and the sins that we hold inside ourselves is scary. It's uncomfortable, it's heartbreaking and painful, and yet it is part of our call as followers of Christ. It's part of our call to look deeply at that which is broken and hurting in the world and to examine the sins, individual and collective, that are the causes and contributors to the brokenness and hurt. It is part of our call to pray and listen and ask the Holy Spirit to show us the way. It is part of that responsibility that we are given when we are given the Holy Spirit. So what does all this have to do with Pentecost? I wonder if in the midst of this pandemic, in the midst of another wave of uncovering the racialized violence in our country, in this exhausting, messy time, if we need Pentecost more than ever, if we need the Holy Spirit to come upon us all and call us to examine those places in ourselves and in our systems and in our communities where sin is present, where injustice and inequalities are being revealed. We need those tongues of fire, calling us to hear and see the Holy Spirit, however and wherever she shows up, be it eventually back in our beloved sanctuary or for now, creatively in the many ways we are connecting with God and each other, serving our neighbors, and striving to creatively and faithfully be the church here and now. We need this Holy Spirit to connect us and bind us together as beloved humanity and as this particular congregation of Zion Lutheran. This work is not easy, friends. None of it. Not the internal work of shift and change and repentance and courage. Not the communal work of figuring out who we are as a church if we're not in our space and doing the things we're used to. It's not easy. There's a lot of brokenness, and it's complex and intricate in ways that we each are complicit and connected to. It's a lot to hold. And it's exhausting and tiring. And so, where's the gospel? Where is that good news? Sometimes the gospel and the good news is a little harder to reach for than other times. And I find myself this week with these texts and this world around us having to dig a little more deeply. But I'm reminded, and God is present as God reminds us, that the gospel is that we are not alone. We are not the first group of a ragtag faithful Jesus followers to be huddled in an upper room, hunkering down and wondering, what next, Jesus? This is not how the story is supposed to go. We're not the first group of faithful that have had the rug pulled out from under them, been thrown into a transition we were not expecting, and to be asked to try new things and be creative and figure out what it even means to be church. We're not the first group of people to look at society around them and see injustices and pain and hurt and long for and work for another way. We're not the first, and we won't be the last. And God is with us in it. When the Holy Spirit comes upon us, whether it's to help us to understand one another or to listen to our neighbors in new ways, or when the Holy Spirit shows us the sins and challenges to retain and examine and make change, we are following Christ. We're being that church. And we pray that we may be filled with the Holy Spirit. I'd like to end our reflection today with a prayer written by the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King in the summer of 1953. And it is a prayer that lives on in its need for today. Let us pray. Most gracious and all-wise God, before whose face the generations rise and fall, thou in whom we live and move and have our being, we thank thee for all of thy good and gracious gifts, for life and for health, for food and for raiment, for the beauties of nature and the love of human nature. We come before thee painfully aware of our inadequacies and shortcomings. We realize that we stand surrounded with mountains of love, and we deliberately dwell in the valley of hate. We stand amid the forces of truth and deliberately lie. We are forever offered the high road, and yet we choose to travel the low road. For these sins, O God, forgive. Break the spell of that which blinds our minds. Purify our hearts that we may see. O God, in these turbulent days when fear and doubt are mounting high, give us broad visions, penetrating eyes, and the power of endurance. Help us to work with renewed vigor for a warless world, for a better distribution of wealth, and for a siblinghood that transcends race or color. In the name and spirit of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Uplifted by the promise, hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need. We call on your spirit of unity, giving thanks for our different vocations. Activate and utilize the diverse gifts present in your church, that they reveal your love for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We call on your spirit of life present in the air, wind, humidity, storms, and oxygen in our atmosphere, breathing energy into all things. Heal with your breath the whole creation, especially those who struggle to breathe. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We call on your spirit of righteousness wherever we as a people are divided, unite us. Wherever we are prideful, humble us. Give each one of us a heart for justice and empathy. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We call on your spirit of healing. Bless nurses, doctors, midwives, chaplains, hospice workers, and medical staff, and all medical workers as they care. Emergency medical staff and all medical workers as they care for those in need. We pray for all who long for comfort, especially Linda, Doris, Jeff, Tracy, Andrea, Helen, Sylvia, Suzanne, Edward, Mike, Romero, Annette, Maida, Carol, Barb, Janet, Laura, William, Julaine, David, John, Carolyn, William, Lori, the Saddle family, the Gary family, Terry, Sandy, Joe, Sally, and Adrian, Amy's father, Barbara, Chal, Melanie, Alex, Kali, and Anne. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We call on your spirit of friendship. Open our eyes to the way we can reach out to one another. Surprise us daily with unexpected grace, that we rejoice in every blessing you send. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We call on your spirit of hope, as you have led your saints in all times and places. Stir in us the desire to follow their example, leading us from death to new life in you. We especially remember Julia, Jean, John, Ruth, Bob, Tom, Marjorie, Jim, and Phyllis. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed by God, even in the hardest of times, we are called to give to the church, the community, and the world. And so many of you are giving in so many ways. And so this morning, we ask a blessing on all the many ways that you give and that we give. Your mercy is great, O God, and your gifts sustain our lives. You enrich us with good things and bless us with your care and love. With acts of giving, we express our thanks. By caring for others, we honor your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. As Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come thou fount of Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us in worship this morning. Although I know we'd all like to be together in our sanctuary, we can certainly still gather in this way and share our faith together. As Pastor Anna likes to say, we're finding new ways to be the church. And I think as you listen to the announcements this morning, you can see that we are doing that. We're finding new ways to be the church. We have a lot going on at Zion Lutheran Church, and we still have a lot to do. But together we can certainly accomplish God's work. Thanks this morning to Ryan and Corey for the worship preparation, for the technical support. Thanks to Pastor Anna, Debbie, and Cheryl for leading us in worship. And we also give thanks this morning to Christine and Amy for the wonderful music that accompanied our service this morning. We appreciate those gifts of their music. And speaking of music, do you have a favorite hymn that you are longing to hear? Are you aching to sing Blessed Assurance, pining for peace like a river, yearning for you satisfy the hungry heart? Well, if that's the case, if you have a favorite hymn, please let Amy know. We will be taking hymn requests for the services during the summer. So just email Amy or call her. You can email her at aer64@verizon.net. Or you can call her and talk to her in person at 413-442-3783. And Amy is going to be very happy to play all of our favorite hymns. She wants all of us to sing very loudly at home so she can hear us. And she's thinking about us and really wants to enrich our music. So please contact her with your favorite hymns. In June, we are going to continue our Thursday programs. We've had a great variety of things going on in the month of May. Everything from dinner church to prayer services, game night, jazz vespers. So pay attention to your emails and newsletter this week, and we will be having new programming in June. So I hope you'll join us for that. It's been a really, really good experience, and I want to give my thanks to Ryan and Pastor Anna for preparing those opportunities to gather and to making those happen. Another opportunity for us to gather is on Tuesday mornings from 10 to 10:15 a.m. for a spirit break. And this is a guided time of reflection, prayer, and refreshment with John Kidd as our guide. So please join us on Tuesday mornings. You can RSVP to John at john.s.kidd@gmail.com. And it's a nice time of good reflection, and let's see if we can get a few more folks to tune into that and grow that spirit break. Thanks to Helen Kimple, the plant sale is gonna go forward this year. It's a new way given these times, but Helen's been busy digging along with a few other folks, and there's plants gonna be for sale on June 6th. Orders have to be received by Thursday, June 4th. There's an email address. It was in the newsletter last week. So please support the plant sale. Pickup will be in the parking lot across from the church on Saturday, June 6th. And payment is by check or exact cash amount. So look forward to that in the days ahead here. As we had previewed back, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks ago, we were gonna have a book group to read and discuss This is God's Table, Finding Church Beyond the Walls. And the author, as you know, is our very own Pastor Anna. And Mark Messina has agreed to lead the discussions. We're going to have 3 discussions around the book. Mark will lead the first 2. And then on the 3rd session, Pastor Anna will join us and be able to answer questions and help guide us through some other parts of the book and give us some great insights from her experience that led to the creation of this book. We are going to have sessions on June 23rd, July 7th, and July 21st. And that's a Tuesday. Those are Tuesdays, and they will be at 7 o'clock in the evening. So there'll be an email next week. It'll be in the newsletter next week with the details on those sessions and how you can order the book. So please join us for this. I think it's going to be a really good experience. This afternoon, the council will meet. We will continue our planning for our church life during the weeks ahead. So please pray for the council's work. Please contact any of us if you have input, if you have concerns. We're very interested in hearing from the congregation and making sure that we plan for the weeks ahead and we continue to be the church in new ways until we can all gather together safely again. And then please don't forget to join us for the coffee hour this morning after the worship service. So we'll join together for some great discussion, catch up on what everybody's doing. And the link is in the email with your Sunday bulletin. So please join us this morning after worship for the coffee hour. It's a really good time. It's a good chance to see everybody's faces. And those are our announcements for today. And so I will turn it back over to Pastor Anna, and she will continue our worship service with the blessing.
Thank you, Dave. And it was brought to my attention that in the bulletin, it says the coffee hour is at 11:15, but really we're just having coffee hour as soon as service is over, which flexibility in terms of how long the service goes. So disregard what the bulletin says and join us, you know, 3-5 minutes after this stream ends and we'll join together for coffee hour. Let us go into our day with this blessing. May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Christ is risen. Go in. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Thank you.